praise the Lord. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Our God is great. Would you just pray with me for a moment? Holy Father, we bless you today and we thank you for your goodness and for your grace. We thank you because you're wonderful. We thank you because you're holy. God, we thank you today, God, even though our hearts are just a tad bit heavy, God, this is still the day that you have made and we are rejoicing and we are glad. God, we thank you that today we can come and celebrate a life that's well lived. God, and I pray even now as we move forward, God, throughout the rest of this service, that you would just have your way in this place. God, we pray for a word of comfort that will come forth for this family and for these friends. God, for all of the colleagues that have come and gathered today, God. God, I pray now, God, that you would just touch us and let your anointing be in this house in the name of Jesus. Thank you now in advance for what you're about to do. Thank you for what you've already done. And we're going to praise you forevermore in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, clap your hands one more time. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless all of you all. I am so grateful to be here this morning. And if I can reach back for just a moment and just let you know, I'm going to tell you like Elizabeth Taylor told her eight husbands, right? I won't be holding you long. Okay. Praise the Lord. Listen, I'm glad she turned the timer off. Amen. Thank you so much. but I'm so glad to be here today. I certainly want to give honor to all of these pastors and ministers that are here on the podium on tonight, and to all of my colleagues, the legislators from the state of Kansas and abroad, those of you that have come to pay your respects to Representative Gail Finney, and of course to my family. Amen. To my big brother, Gerald, man. You know, I love you, man. And all of you all. I can't say enough. You know, I'm like Gerald. I'm in the mafia family as well. You know, we had this thing for a minute, me, him, and Gail and Pat, because, you know, I told him that I've taken over his place as the longevity person in our family for the in-laws. And he said, no. I said, well, yeah, because you took a sabbatical. Then you came back. But I ain't never left, so I've been here, so. But Gil told me that don't count, so we're going to leave it with him being the longest standing in the family, amen, for the in-laws. So I'm grateful today. Listen, I love you all, and I just am so grateful to what God has done, you know, in our lives. I could talk about Gil all day, just like the rest of you could. You know, there's so many stories as I sat and I thought, you know, about some of the things that were going on. I remember the spanking bill that she presented before committee. I know a lot of people may have forgotten about that, but it had nationwide attention, you know, because what they were saying was actually they were saying that she was trying to get child abuse legalized, and that was not the case at all. But Gail had no fear when she thought something was right. She had no fear in bringing forward what she thought was right. And there were some things that needed to happen. That's why all of them big polls we've been talking about all day, that's why that got taken care of, because of her tenacity to move forward and get that done. So I'm grateful today, amen, for my cousin, sister, amen, Gail Alexandria Finney. And so today we stand in solidarity before the mystery of life and death, because the Bible says that the last enemy that we face will be death. And so it's a mystery that we face, not to say goodbye, but to say farewell to our sister Gail Alexandria Finney. She's a daughter, she's a loving wife, she's a devoted mother, she's a grandmother, a niece, a sister, a counselor, and a friend to many people. I was listening to Senator Betts say he flew 9,000 miles to be here today. That's saying something about this great woman that we celebrate. You can clap, that's fine. Although her departure from this earthly realm, it ends an era, but we cannot forget who she was. And I don't believe we ever will. It ends in Erica, but her legacy of love and her legacy of service is going to continue forever. Come on, even after today, we're not going to just forget her, because we can't leave. You know, you cannot leave a footprint in the sand and be completely forgotten. Come on, not after just one service. We've heard so many things. We've watched videos. We've listened to the family. We've listened to colleagues. And it's hard for us to leave footprints in the sand of time and then just be forgotten just like that. So you're going to remember what she did well. You'll probably remember many of the things that were said about her today and over the last several days. And many more memories will come to the forefront of your mind. But most of all, we'll praise God for the life that she lived. We'll praise God for the legacy that she leaves. We'll praise God for the love that she displayed and for the service that she rendered to all of her fellow man. That's who we're serving, and that's who we're celebrating and blessing God for today. Would you do me a favor one more time and clap your hands for the life of Representative Gail Alexandria Finney. I want to read a passage of scripture, and I will hasten to my seat. Philippians chapter 1. God just kind of dropped this in my spirit, and I'm going to spend a few moments, and I'll talk about it, and then we're going to move on. Verse number 20 and 21 from the New King James Version. It said, according to my earnest expectation and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness, as always. So now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I can draw your attention in for just a moment, the Apostle Paul, he wrote this letter to the church at Philippi while he was a Roman prisoner. And even though he was incarcerated at this particular time, he yet proclaimed victory in Christ. Paul had done so many things to push forward the agenda of Christ during his time, but now he's in a situation where things are not looking as wonderful as they should be or could be, but he still proclaimed victory. See, whether you know it or not, the experience of the believer is meant to be the mind of Christ being displayed into our lives, which results in our minds being transformed to the point that we realize no matter what goes on in life, God is going to work it all out. No matter how you feel about what this looks like, God is going to work it all out. See, you see, God has a purpose for your life, and that purpose is that he will be glorified in you. The Bible teaches us in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. If you can understand that, what we are is we are a generation of people who have been chosen to be adopted into the royal family of God. Come on, and made holy through the blood of Jesus, so we can tell a dying world about a living Savior. See, this is something that the Apostle Paul understood. He wasn't concerned about having a whole lot of material things because he had already accomplished a whole lot. Come on, we recognize that he had all types of degrees. Basically, if we looked at his learning and his education of that day, it would amount to 5 master's degrees of the day. Come on, he had all of the learning that he needed, and he had accomplished so many things, but it wasn't about the material things that he had accomplished, and it wasn't even about happy with life situations or circumstances. His sole purpose was spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was all about Jesus Christ and giving him honor for everything, giving him honor in the good times, giving him honor in the bad times, giving him honor in the happy times, in the sad times, in times of indifference, and also in times of contentment. It was all about giving God glory. The Bible admonishes us to give thanks in everything, for this is the will of God concerning you. I want you to understand that just like God had a purpose for Apostle Paul's life, he has a purpose for each one of us. And I believe that Gail fulfilled the purpose that God had set up for her life. That's why every last one of us in this place has been impacted in some way or another by the life that she lived. Come on, she fulfilled what God had called her to do. And just as God has a purpose for life, he also has a purpose for death. And that is for our gain. See, Paul had some things that he struggled with in his body too. Just like Gail did, I began to think about her on the other day. While we were together, we stayed in the apartments at the Ramada in Topeka doing our sessions, and she stayed right across the hallway from where I was. And many times I would go down to check on her because I knew how sick she was. See, and a lot of folks didn't really know because every time she came out popping. Come on, y'all know. Those of you that have been with her, y'all know every time she came out, she was cute. And she meant to do it that way. because she didn't want people feeling sorry for her. She didn't want people sympathizing for her, you know, because she had a job that she was trying to do. And so sometimes I would know how sick she was and how bad she felt. So I would go down and I would talk with her a little bit, and we would sit and we would just chat, and she would pull herself together and say, and I'd tell her, well, listen, you need to just get some rest. You should just stay in. But we had a vote that we had to do, or she had a committee that she had to testify in, or somebody else had a committee that they had to testify before, and she wanted to be there to show her support because she was all in for helping people. This is what she did. Gail understood that there were some things that were going on with her life, and soon, all of these things were going to be over. We had this kind of conversation. I remember after she had her heart attack, I remember going to see her in the hospital. And that's the reason that I even wore my collar today, because that's what we talked about the day that I saw her. It just happened to be a first Sunday, and I had my collar on. So I went, and I talked to her, and she had that book on her desk, Gerald. She had that big notebook on her desk. Yeah, she had the note. And I said, okay, what's the notebook for? She said, that's all my information. I said, well, what's all the information for? She said, well, just in case something happens, I want to make sure that they know what to do, who to call, and all the information that's necessary. And I told her, well, listen, you need to call Drill and tell him to take that home, or I can drop it off for you, because this is not that day. I talked to her many, many times to encourage her, because what would happen is that she would find enough strength. She would muster up enough strength to continue moving, to continue on with doing and fulfilling the agenda that she had. And so I told her, no, I need you to take that book home. And so when you get there, you just leave it at the house. We're not going to worry about that, because I believe that God has more for you. But there were some things that went on, and she paralleled to Paul, because Paul dealt with some stuff in his body. The Bible said that he sought God three times about a thorn that he had in his flesh. He kept asking him, God, I need you to do something about this. Now the word doesn't tell us what his issue was, but it just lets us know that something was going on with his flesh, and it was causing him some discomfort. And so he asked him three times, what can I do? Will you do something? But God began to tell him after the last time, he just said, don't worry about it, because my grace is sufficient. My grace is sufficient. You don't have to worry about nothing else that's going on. I know you got this dealing with. I know you're uncomfortable. I know it doesn't feel good. I know it may not even look good on you, but don't worry, because my grace is sufficient. God's righteousness at Christ's expense. It is sufficient for you. He talked about it. So he understood that there were some things that he was going to have to deal with while he was here on this earth. I believe that Gail had the same understanding, because she had some physical issues that she dealt with for many years. And it didn't seem like she was ever going to get free of them. But she wouldn't let that stop her, because she knew that God had a plan and a purpose for her life. And her grace, amen, and his grace allowed her to be all that she could be and do all that she could do in the framework of time that she was given. When we go to the cemetery, we look at headstones. And when we look at them, normally they have a name and they have dates. They have a date from the beginning and they have a date from the end. But in the middle of that date, there is a dash. I want to ask you what you've done with your dash. Because as we look at the dash from Gail Alexandria Finney, we can see that many things have taken place in her life, all the way from the CAC all the way up to now. Come on, things have changed, and she's done some things. She had a plan, and she had some purpose, and she made sure that she stayed focused. Even for me, coming into the legislature in 2013 as a freshman legislator, I came in as green could possibly be. I had no clue about what was going on. I listened to the news and I watched people, and I knew some of the legislators. So, you know, it wasn't completely just oblivious to me. But once I got in, there was so much that I had to learn. And so my learning curve was huge. And so what happened was I ended up with some mentors. And Gail was my biggest mentor, because she's the one that taught me how to read bills. She's the one that taught me how to understand what bundling was. She's the one that taught me what somebody said and what they really meant. I'm not going to tell all y'all's information. But she took me aside and she taught me, and can I help you understand something? The first thing that she told me when we got there, she said, the first thing you got to remember, don't take none of this stuff personal. Because sometimes things would come out, and sometimes things would get heated, and sometimes, you know, things would turn out and be spoken in a way that could get under your skin. But she said, don't take it personal, because we would deal with this on the floor and then we all going to dinner together. So I'm grateful for the time that I got to spend in the legislature with Gayle Finney. See, but she understood there was only a certain amount of time that she had, so she did everything that she could to get done what God had purposed for her to do while she was here. She tried to support as many people and good causes as she could, just to let people know that somebody cared. She would often go to events with her body racked in pain because she believed in being committed to her position and being a woman who kept her word. If she said she was coming, she came. If she said she was going to do it, she tried to make sure it got done. See, sometimes she really needed to be resting, but she would go because she wanted people to know that she was serious about making a positive impact in our society. Even when she passed, she had some things on her schedule that she was planning to do. She was still moving. Sometimes she was sick, but she kept pushing. Sometimes she was misunderstood, but she kept pushing. Sometimes she had to fight, but she kept pushing. Sometimes her name was scandalized, but she kept pushing. She kept pushing because she knew that one day she was going to get a promotion and she'd be able to relax and rest from the work of the day and enjoy the next position. She had been talking about retirement for several years, but she was so passionate about her family and community that she continued working until she got the call that she was being promoted. I started to think about it. You know, we think about promotion, especially when we're children. We go to school and we get promoted from grade to grade. When we are in kindergarten, we'll go to first grade and go all the way through the 12th grade. And when we get to the 12th grade, for a lot of people, that's when we're finished. For a lot of people, that's just the beginning because there's still more schooling. But we have gotten promoted from place to place to place. And what promotion means is that I'm moving to the next place. I'm moving to the next level in what I've got to do. I know that somebody said that we came here for a funeral today, but can I help you to understand that when you say funeral, that means somebody's dead. But somebody said that this was a homegoing celebration, so that means that it ain't about nobody being dead, but it's about somebody transitioning and moving to the next place. This is what's happening with Gayle now. She ain't here. I know her body's here, but she's not here anymore. But she has transitioned and moved to the next place because she got her promotion. See, we got to grab a hold of that and understand that it's promotion time in the life of Gayle Alexandria Finney. See, even though she leaves a legacy of love and service, leaving behind this old world and trading it in for a new one was a promotion. Championship winning coach and NBA executive Pat Riley once said, being ready is not enough, but you got to be prepared for promotion or any other significant change. And can I help you to understand that Gayle was prepared? Oh, come on, we talked many, many times about her belief. I know that a lot of you think, well, I didn't see her there and I didn't see her here. It wasn't even all about that, because it's about what's here. Come on, that's what it is. Come on, it doesn't matter about what other people think about you. It's about you and your relationship. See, I have no place to take you. I have no place to put you. I can only talk about what God has spoken and give you the truth. So it's up to you to grab a hold of it. And the thing that she let me know was that she believed in Jesus Christ. She believed that he was the Son of God. She believed that he rose from the dead, and he did it just for us. So I'm thanking God for promotion today. When Paul had come to the end of his life, I can imagine him sitting in prison knowing that he would soon be on his way to Nero's chopping block to lose his head for the cause of Christ. At that time, he left some instructions for his son in the ministry, Timothy, and he encouraged him to be diligent about continuing to spread the good news of the gospel. Paul had now come to a point in his life that the mantle was now being passed on to the next generation. We saw the mantle being passed on last night to the next representative of District 84. We saw the mantle being passed on today. We heard it said, because we have seen an exemplary public servant. Amen. We've seen a servant leader come before us. And so what we have to do now, not just talk about it, not even just pray about it, not even just have good thoughts about it, but it's time to be about it. See, we've been left an example that showed us how to get some stuff done. So if you want to get some stuff done, all you got to do is just look at what Representative Gayle Finney has left us. Look at the legacy of service that she's left us. Look at how she prepared for promotion. Look how she took care of the things she needed to do while she was here. Look at what she did in the dash. Paul passed the mantle to Timothy. And in 2 Timothy 4 and 7 and 8, we heard it a minute ago. He said, I fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, come on, this is what we've been waiting on. Finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. I believe that if Gail could verbally communicate to you today, she would tell you that she fought that fight. She fought a good fight. She's now finished her course. And she kept the faith the entire time. Come on. You know, it wasn't easy. Come on. Some days were tough. Some days she didn't feel good. Some days she didn't feel like she was going to make it. But she stayed focused on the race. And now she's ready to receive the crown that God said is hers. I believe if she could tell you anymore, she would tell you, don't worry about her now because everything's all right. Come on, because there's no more pain. Oh, there's no more sorrow. There's no more sickness. Come on, there's no more disease. There's no more illness. There's no more misunderstanding. There's no more attitudes. Come on, y'all know it. Legislators, y'all have to deal with attitudes. Because when you start talking to people, when they come out to your gatherings, they come out to your coffees, you know, they come out to hear what you got to say. A lot of folks come in with attitude because they don't believe you're going to do what you say you're going to do. Gail was different. She did what she said she was going to do. But she would tell you, everything's fine. I'm not dealing with the issues of life anymore. Me and Jerry, we ain't fighting no more. That fight's over. Everything's good. Y'all have to know who Jerry is. You think about it. She said, I'm not in pain anymore. I'm not worried anymore because I've been promoted. As I go to my seat, to my family, I just want to say to you to be encouraged. Even though this is a very uncomfortable season for us, when I came in, I was just overcome with emotion. And, you know, I sat there, and thank God that I had my mask on, because you all would have just seen me just dealing with my emotions, because she means so much to so many people. You know, Gail was that one family member that everybody just kind of rallied around. Whenever she come by, everybody just kind of gravitated to her because she was that one. You know, everybody loved her because she loved everybody. Gail was one, when she would laugh, her laugh was contagious. If she laughed for more than a minute, we all gonna be laughing because, you know, it was just contagious like that. But I want to say to you to be encouraged. Gerald, be encouraged. Gerald Jr., y'all be encouraged. Jason, Sean, be encouraged. God has got this thing under control. Even though this is a tough time for us, this is a tough transition for us, God has everything under control. And as you go through the days ahead, he's going to give you the strength to continue to move forward in this life. At some point, the sting and the pain of this loss is going to go away. God is going to take the pain away, but he's always going to have, you're always going to have the memories of your mother, the memories of your wife, the memories of your cousin, your sister, your niece. Come on, you're always going to have the memories because they will last a lifetime. Will you pray with me? Father, we just now thank you. I pray that as we have shared what you said to say, that you would bless your people today. Those that are here, God, I pray that they would come to know you if they don't know you. That they would know you in the pardon of their sins and say yes to you. God, those that have come on the day, God, that are looking for an answer, I pray, God, that they will begin to look to the hills from where their help comes from, because our help comes from you. I pray for divine favor and blessing upon this family. God, I've covered Gerald now in prayer. I pray that you would touch him now. Give him strength for the days ahead. God, I pray, God, even for energy in his body. God, as he has dealt with a severe trauma, God, it's going to be exhausting the days ahead without his girlfriend. But God, I pray now in the name of Jesus that you would touch him and strengthen him and fortify him to be able to stand and continue to move on in the name of Jesus. Bless now your people that are here. God, bless us throughout the rest of this day and throughout the rest of this service. And we'll give you glory for all things you've done and for what you've spoken. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen.
Come on, the people said amen one more time. We thank God for the message and the messenger on today. My brothers and sisters, as Jackson Mortuary comes, we ask you to please remain seated until one of the ushers come and usher you around. Amen. Amen. We will do this in a timely fashion. I'm going to ask as they get ready, then the clergy will come down with me. And then I know Brother Gerald is going to come and stand with us as well.
For me, may the work I've done speak for me. When I'm resting in my grave, there is nothing else that can be said. Done down here, speak for me, and may the life I've lived speak for me. May the life that I've lived speak for me. May the life I've lived down here speak for me. Oh, and may the service I've given down here speak for me. Yes, may the service I've given down here I can. Sometimes friends don't understand. May the service I've given down here speak for me. Oh, the work I've done. Oh, it seems so small. Sometimes it seems like nothing at all. Oh, but when I stand before my God, I wanna hear Him say, "Well done." May the work I've done down here speak for me. Speak for me. May the work I've done down here speak for me. Yes, may the work I've done down here speak for me. Oh, when I'm resting nothing else that can be said. May the work I've done down here speak for me. May the work I've done down here speak for me. Yes, may the work I've done down here speak for me.
Constitutional issues regarding citizens' property rights and their due process, I'm going to be fighting for them. So you can call it what you want, but I'm going to get out there and put the gloves on when it comes to representing my citizens and the citizens of the state of Kansas.
If you have a suspended license and you can't get insurance and you're in a wreck and you hit someone, that hurts all of us.
State Representative Gail Finney estimates 50% of drivers with suspended licenses, maybe more, drive anyway.
As you had mentioned before, when you're driving down the street, chances are you're going to pass by someone that has a suspended driver's license.
The more uninsured accidents in a state, the more the cost of no-fault insurance goes up for everyone, while those who don't work find themselves relying on state social services to feed their families.
Just an increasing cycle that seems to never end.
And believe it or not, the exploding prison population is a factor in this problem, too. Finney is chair of the Commission on Criminal Justice's Subcommittee on Reentry. She says many former prisoners can't find jobs because they don't have a license and can't get one, so they end up back behind bars.
We're trying to reduce the mass incarceration in Kansas. That has been a big concern here.
Finney says Kenyell's experience is vital for lawmakers to understand.
I want them to realize that this could happen to them, and I want them to see the impact that it's had on this community.
You can see these poles from the highway. You can't really see the wooden poles from the highway.
People that have a pole in their yards or across the street, but it affects our whole neighborhood.
Finney says property values are already falling because of these. Her bill would stop what she calls the bait and switch tactics that led to them. That's all Kenyell says she wants now.
Maybe somehow, some way, make this better for others.
In Wichita, Pilar Pedraza, Kate News, on your side.
Initially, when Westar went out and negotiated the contract with people, they showed them pictures of a pole like this wooden pole. So people signed the contracts based off of this. What they end up getting are these poles right here. It's 105-foot large, and some of them have these big concrete bases. Look how tall this is. And this is the actual street. The green 1100 block, this is one block. But look at the condenseness of this. This is horrific. Would anybody like to have a pole like this in their yard? And it's going to affect generations to come in about these Wichita's. People are losing their home values. People are trying to move. And the people that they have compensated is just not enough. And I don't think that West Star has gone far enough to get back
to this. I think that we'll have some support in this. Because this has had some mothers. You start talking about pregnancy nationwide. We have to take care of our mothers that are bearing our children. And we want to make sure that they're healthy. And we need to find out the reasons that we're having such a high mortality rate.
The 84th District, January 2019, State Representative Gail Finney took the oath of service to the people of the Kansas 84th Legislative District in Northeast Wichita and began serving not her first, not her second, not her third, not her fourth, not her fifth, but her sixth term, Wichita. I can read on and on and on, but I hope she won't be embarrassed if I recognize her as a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority sister, the first lady, and myself, and my line sister. Amen.
Legacy is so much you can see and so much you can't.
Entering the State House in 2009, Finney's impact felt by many across the state.
She represented everybody, the little guy to the big guy. Even the bill with the transmission lines, it benefits the entire state of Kansas, but it hit home in the little community where she grew up at.
Finney got Evergy to commit to investing $1 million in the black community after their controversial power line upgrades in 2019. District 1 Councilman Brandon Johnson worked very closely with her during phase one, and hopes to continue the work in honor of her life.
The timing of her passing as phase two starts with Evergy is not lost on me.
State Senator Aletha Faust-Godeau met Finney when they were in just the seventh grade. She's not only losing a colleague, but a lifelong friend.
We were the first black cheerleaders at Allison Middle School. Just her energy at that time, it was still our relationship in seventh grade.
Faust-Godeau says, although Finney is no longer here to see her legislation through, her legacy will move forward as the work continues.
Gail Finney is a champion for introducing the first medical marijuana bill in the state of Kansas.
Some saying she'll be remembered for her strength and courage.
She was the one that waved the banner the loudest, the strongest.
In her passing, the bar is pretty high, and we all have to live up to that and to be the type of person that she was.
Thank you.